where the circle closed on itself, and sheer will substituted for selflessness. Plagueis understood, too, that there were no powers beyond his reach, none he couldn't master through an effort of will. If a Sith of equal power had preceded him, then that one had taken his or her secrets to the grave, or had locked them away in holocrons that had been destroyed or had yet to surface. The question of whether he and Sidious had discovered something new or rediscovered something ancient was beside the point. All that mattered was that almost a decade earlier, they had succeeded in willing the Force to shift and tip irrevocably to the dark side. Not a mere paradigm shift, but a tangible alteration that could be felt by anyone strong in the Force, and whether or not trained in the Sith or Jedi arts. The shift had been the outcome of months of intense meditation, during which Plagueis and Sidious had sought to challenge the Force for sovereignty and suffuse the galaxy with the power of the dark side. Brazen and shameless, at their own mortal peril, they had waged etheric war, anticipating that their own midichlorians, the Force's proxy army, might marshal to boil their blood or stop the beating of their hearts. Risen out of themselves, discorporate, and as a single entity, they had brought the power of their will to bear, asserting their sovereignty over the Force. No counterforce had risen against them. In what amounted to a state of rapture, they knew that the Force had yielded, as if some deity had been tipped from its throne. On the fulcrum they had fashioned, the light side had dipped and the dark side had ascended. On the same day, they had allowed Venomous to die. Then, by manipulating the Bith's midichlorians, which should have been inert and unresponsive, Plagueis had resurrected him. The enormity of the event had stunned Sidious into silence and overwhelmed and addled 114D's processors. But Plagueis had carried on without assistance, again and again allowing Venomous to die and be returned to life, until the Bith's organs had given out and Plagueis had finally granted him everlasting death. But having gained the power to keep another alive hadn't been enough for him. And so after Sidious had returned to Coruscant, he had devoted himself to internalizing that ability by manipulating the midichlorians that animated him. For several months, he made no progress, but ultimately he began to perceive a measured change. The scars that had grown over his wounds had abruptly begun to soften and fade, and he had begun to breathe more freely than he had in 20 years. He began to sense that not only were his damaged tissues healing, but his entire body was rejuvenating itself. Beneath the transpirator, areas of his skin were smooth and youthful, and he knew that eventually he would cease to age altogether. Drunk on newfound power, then, he had attempted an even more unthinkable act, to bring into being a creation of his own. Not merely the impregnation of some hapless, mindless creature, but the birth of a forceful being. The ability to dominate death had been a step in the right direction, but it wasn't equivalent to pure creation. And so he had stretched out, indeed as if invisible, transubstantiated, to inform every being of his existence and impact all of them. Munoid or insectoid, secure or dispossessed, free or enslaved. A warrior waving a banner in triumph on a battlefield, a ghost infiltrating a dream. But ultimately, to no end. The Force grew silent, as if in flight from him, and many of the animals in his laboratory succumbed to horrifying diseases. Regardless, 8 long years later, Plagueis remained convinced that he was on the verge of absolute success. The evidence was in his own increased midichlorian count, and in the power he sensed in Sidious when he had finally returned to Sojourn. The dark side of the Force was theirs to command, and in partnership, they would someday be able to keep each other alive and to rule the galaxy for as long as they saw fit. but he had yet to inform Sidious of this. It was more important that Sidious remain as focused on manipulating events in the profane world as Plagueis was intent on dominating the realm of the Force, of which the mundane was only a gross and distorted reflection. To be sure, the light had been extinguished, but for how long and at what cost? He recalled a stellar eclipse he had witnessed on a long-forgotten world, whose single moon was of perfect size and distance to blot out the light of the system's primary. The result hadn't been total darkness, but illumination of a different sort, singular and diffuse, that had confused the birds and had permitted the stars to be seen in what would have been broad daylight. Even totally blocked, the primary had shone from behind the satellite's disk, and when the moon moved on, there had been a moment of light almost too intense to bear. Gazing into Sojourn's darkening sky, he wondered what calamity the Force was planning in retreat to visit upon him or Sidious or both of them for willfully tipping the balance. Was retribution merely waiting in the wings, as it had been on Coruscant 20 years earlier? It was a dangerous time, more dangerous than his earliest years as an apprentice, when the dark side might have consumed him at any moment. Plagueis began to pace the cool floor.
No Sith have ever been in the position in which we now find ourselves, Darth Sidious. In step with the reemergence of the dark side, fortified by the signs and omens, certain that revenge and victory are near at hand. If the Jedi would abide by their philosophy of acting in accordance with the Force, of doing what is right, they would roll over for the dark. But they resist. Yoda and the rest of the Council members will double their meditation sessions in an effort to peer into the future, only to discover it clouded and unknowable, only to discover that complacency has opened the door to catastrophe. If indeed they have been acting in accordance with the Force, how could we be succeeding in tipping the balance? How could the dark side be gaining ground? In fact, the Jedi have fallen away from their self-assigned duty, their noble path. Could they have prevented it? Perhaps by having remained in control of the Republic, by electing and re-electing Jedi Supreme Chancellors, or perhaps by absenting themselves completely from the affairs of the Republic and attending to their arcane rituals in the belief that right thinking by them would keep the Republic strong and on course. The galaxy tipped into the light instead of having allowed themselves to become marshals and enforcers.
He cast a questioning look at Sidious.
Do you see the grand error of their ways? They execute the Republic's business as if it were the business of the Force. But has a political body ever succeeded in being the arbiter of what is right and just? How easy it is for them to bask in self-assurance in their castle on Coruscant. But in so doing, they have rendered themselves ill-equipped for the world we have spent a millennium bringing into being.
He cleared his throat.
We're going to back them into a contradiction, Darth Sidious. We're going to force them to confront the moral quandary of their position and reveal their flaws by requiring them to oversee the conflicts that plague their vaunted Republic. Only Dooku and a handful of others have grasped the truth. All those years ago, when I first met him on Serenno, I thought, what a blow it would be to the Order if he could be enticed to leave and embrace the dark side. What a panic it might incite. For if one could leave, then 10 or 20 or 30 could follow, and the hollowness at the center of the Order would be plain for all to see.
The Mune's eyes narrowed.
One can't be content to abide by the rules of the Jedi Order or the Force. Only by making the Force serve us have we prevailed. 8 years ago, We shifted the galaxy, Darth Sidious. And that shift is now irreversible.
Someday soon, the Sith would wield both, with Sidious the face of the former, and Plagueis behind the scenes advising him about the latter. Like Plagueis, Sidious had moved judiciously, for unintended repercussions in the real world could be as damaging to the Sith imperative as blowback from the Force. The fact that the Force had not struck back argued that their partnership was something unique and in accordance with the will of the Force. Plagueis' self-imposed isolation had taken a toll on some of the plans he and Sidious had engineered for the Trade Federation and other groups. But Plagueis had made what amounted to a full recovery from his injuries, and the dark side was no longer simply on the ascendant, but risen and climbing toward the zenith. The Yanchori crisis was the first time that Plagueis had sanctioned Sidious's direct involvement in galactic events. Until then, events manipulated by the Sith had been accomplished through the use of intermediaries. But when Sidious enlisted the aid of the Deveronian smuggler to instigate the Yanchori, he had not only made contact by holoprojector, without revealing his Sith identity, of course.
The Force provides, Sidious. As nature provides more male beings in the aftermath of war, the Force, ever mindful of balance, provides beings strong in the dark side when light has ruled for too long. This Zabrak bodes well.
The Sith Lords who follow us will pay tribute to your wisdom, Master, Sidious said in earnestness. Plagueis stood and touched him on the shoulder.
No, Lord Sidious, because we are the end of the line.
He gestured broadly.
Everything done here has been for a single purpose. To extend our reign indefinitely. Conception, but rather through the Force.
Surprise and disbelief mingled in Sidious's blue eyes. The Force?
Yes, but I fail to exercise due caution. As we attempt to wrest the powers of life and death from the Force, as we seek to tip the balance, the Force resists our efforts. Action and reaction, Sidious. Something akin to the laws of thermodynamics. I have been audacious, and the Force has tested me the way Tenebris sought to. Midichlorians are not easily persuaded to execute the dictates of one newly initiated in the mysteries. The Force needs to be won over, especially in work that involves the dark side. It must be reassured that a Sith is capable of accepting authority. Otherwise, it will thwart one's intentions. It will engineer misfortune. It will strike back.
The Maladians.
Perhaps. But in any case, this is why the Jedi Order has descended into decadence and is dragging the Republic down with it. Because the Jedi have lost the allegiance of the Force. Yes, their ability to draw energy from the Force continues, but their ability to use the Force has diminished. Each of their actions engenders an opposite, often unrecognized consequence that elevates those attuned to the dark side, that buoys the efforts of the Sith and increases our power. Yet our use of that power requires delicacy. We must be alert to moments when the light side falters and openings are created. Then, and only then, when all the conditions have been met, can we act without fear of meeting resistance or repercussion. To say that the Force works in mysterious ways is to admit one's ignorance. For any mystery can be solved through the application of knowledge and unrelenting effort. As we had our way with the Senate, and as we will soon have our way with the Republic and the Jedi, we will have our way with the Force.
To the odds of survival, nature had instead made the Asalamir species strong in the Force. So strong, in fact, that several of the creatures acting in concert could create a force bubble encompassing kilometers rather than meters. In a sense, the Jedi Order had done the same on a galactic scale, Plagueis believed, by bathing the galaxy in the energy of the light side of the Force, or more accurately, by fashioning a force bubble that had prevented infiltration by the dark side, until Tenebris' master had succeeded in bursting the bubble, or at least shrinking it. How the Order's actions could be thought of as balancing the Force had baffled generations of Sith, who harbored no delusions regarding the Force's ability to self-regulate. The Yanchori former convict wasn't the only new addition to Plagueis' island facility. In the 11 years that had elapsed since the capture of Venomous and the recruitment of Sidious, Plagueis had collected more than a dozen beings of diverse species and had been subjecting them to a wide range of experiments involving volition, telepathy, healing, regeneration, and life extension, with some promising results. As for the Bith would-be Sith Lord, he was alive and well, though kept comatose more often than not, and always under the watchful photoreceptors of 114D or a host of custodial droids. Plagueis hadn't lost interest in Venomous by any means, but the Yanchori's immunity to force suggestion, an immunity the species shared with Hutts, Toydarians, and others, had provided him with a new line of investigation. Unlike Isilimiri, which created a force bubble in the presence of danger, the Yanchori were in perpetual state of involuntary immunity to force suggestion. The fact that immunity was in a sense hardwired into them meant that the ability was an adaptation prompted by a past threat to the survival of the species. To Plagueis, it meant that the Yanchori's midichlorians had evolved to provide protection to a species that was naturally strong in the Force. If that were indeed the case, then the Yanchori were living proof that the Sith of the Bane line had been on the right path from the very start. For while toppling the Jedi Order and the Republic was essential to the task of restoring order to the galaxy, that goal belonged to the realm of the ordinary, to the world that was nothing more than a byproduct of the eternal struggle between the light and dark forces, both of which were beyond any concepts of good or evil. The greater goal of the Sith involved toppling the Force itself and becoming the embodiment of the galaxy's animating principle. It had been theorized by Jedi and Sith alike that balance between the light and dark sides was actually under the guidance of a group of discorporate entities, the ones called the Celestials, perhaps, who had merged themselves with the Force thousands of generations earlier and had continued to guide the fate of the galaxy ever since. In effect, a higher order of intermediaries whose powers were beyond the understanding of mortal beings. But many Sith viewed the notion with disdain, for the theoretical existence of such a group had little bearing on the goal of making the Force subservient to the will of an enlightened elite. Only the Sith understood that sentient life was on the verge of a transformative leap, that through the manipulation of midichlorians, or the overthrow of the forceful group that supervised them, the divide between organic life and the Force could be bridged, and death could be erased from the continuum. As evidenced by those few lords who had managed to perpetuate their spirits after physical death, foremost among them, Emperor Vitiate, who was said to have lived 1,000 years, the ancient Sith had come halfway across that bridge. But those few had been so focused on worldly power that they had ended up trapping themselves between realms, that they had never provided the Order with guidance from beyond, attested to the fact that their influence had been negligible and had long since faded from the world. In the same way that the pre-Bane Sith had been responsible for their own extinction, the great dark side lords of the past had doomed themselves to the nether realm through their attempts to conquer death by feeding off the energies of others, rather than by tapping the deepest strata of the Force and learning to speak the language of the midichlorians. Plagueis was finally learning to do that, and was just beginning to learn how to persuade, prompt, cajole, and coax them into action. Already he could command them to promote healing, and now he had been successful in enticing them to lower their defenses.